audience went up like that. We made Vengeance. You know, not hoping too much, and Vengeance just went bang, number one in the indie charts. And then all the record companies that turned us down 2 years earlier came begging to sign us.
Vengeance sat either at number one or in the top three of the NME indie charts for nearly a year.
I've never, ever, with one exception, thought when I'm writing about how people are going to react to it. Never think about that. I'm just writing. But I didn't remember writing. I wrote it after watching a documentary about Klaus Barbie, the Nazi war criminal in South America.
During the war, Barbie's alleged to have murdered 4,000 people, men, women and children. This symbol of Nazi cruelty could only have escaped retribution at the end of the war with the protection of powerful friends.
Protected by money and powerful friends. At one point, the guy tries to interview him, and he goes up to him and says, "Excuse me, Mr. Barbie." And I was sitting there thinking, you don't go and say, "Excuse me, Mr. Barbie," you go and put a fucking gun in his head. And he made me so angry that I wrote this angry song. I was very good at writing angry songs. I was angry a lot of the time.
I remember hearing it and it kind of just grabs you because it's pumped up.
I believe in justice, I believe in vengeance, I believe in getting the bastards, getting the bastards.
Getting the bastards, getting the bastards, getting the bastards.
I never fucking heard anything like this in my life before. The way they looked, the sound, the lyrics, the attitude, the aggression, the energy, I was caught up in the whole thing.
Justin Sullivan's lyrics were very, very strident and very, well, anti-everything, really. They were sort of anti-establishment, but they weren't a sort of cosy, liberal left sort of club that exists in the music world and the arts world. It was a much more kind of hardcore, some would say quite extreme view of what needed to be done to sort out society and its problems. It wasn't the kind of comfortable sort of nostrums that you heard from people like Billy Bragg, the one who was sort of the poster boy for that kind of thing.
I think that Justin and the band have always had this paradox of the songs that inflame against the underlying principle, which is pacifist, which is anti-war.
The Army were controversial from the get-go because some people thought they were right-wing, some people thought they were left-wing, and some people just thought they were fucking terrifying.
The punk was a confrontational time. The whole point about punk, it was, what are you against, what have you got? It was, everything was confrontational.
Where there is error, may we bring truth. Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope.
Because they died, they only had something to die for. They killed, they only had something to kill for.
And then, of course, as the Thatcher era took hold, the early 80s, fights to kind of political thing.
I'm not allowed to say how many planes joined the raid, but I counted them all out, and I counted them all back.
There was the various riots at Southall and Toxteth. And then there was the miners' strike.
You are next!
That's when we were coming of age, 84, 85, we'd made Vengeance. We were band of the moment in England. And that was the time of the miners' strike.
they had a message, they were out there saying something. The way Justin would stalk the stage, it was very fired up, it was very aggressive.
Justin used to have this on-stage persona, Slade the Leveller, his alter ego.
It was a kind of punk tradition that everyone had names, and the main reason for that is because everybody was on the dole. So you didn't want to use your real name in the local paper because the dole might come after you. And I chose the name Slade the Leveller.
Slade the Leveller was always angry and, you know, his eyebrows were very furrowed.
But at this point, I'd stopped being their agent, I'd become their full-time manager, and we did our first big tour, and it was just up and down England.
We've been steadily building, and it was absolutely fantastic. It was beyond my wildest dreams, you know, just to play packed venues. There'd been a poll done by The Face magazine, you know, who's the best band, best album. That year I was number one, best bass player. Fantastic, you know. So there's quite a lot of attention on me at that time. To go from literally picking the bass up 5 years prior to that to then suddenly get to the best bass player in the country is an amazing thing. But it also puts pressure on you, you know, and I was only 21, 22 at the time.
I'll tell you how that got started. When there was just five or six of us, whatever, we started doing these stupid dances. All this sort of, you know, and then it just caught on until everybody was doing that arm thing.
There was something that I think we used to call the chicken dance years ago, where the shoulders used to go up and down like this. But as the shoulders would move with the beat of the music, then the punches would come like this as well. And then at some points in the song, we'd do this sort of like weird kind of thing like this, and it would end up so going up, down, down, round, up, up, up. It's just something that happened.
It tells a story, and when you watch the following dance into the song, almost like synchronized, it's fantastic. There's hundreds of people doing it, and some of them three people high on each other's shoulders.
You'd be playing and you sort of see, okay, there's two people, three, like, shit, four. You know, you wouldn't see that kind of stuff in a circus, right? It was really inspiring to us, standing there playing, to watch that. It was beautiful.
You think, is this going on stage and I'm watching them because they're far more interesting.
They want to make something happen. They want to create something. I look at people all the time and I'm looking at a light in their eye. It doesn't matter to me how much they dance, how many times. We were singing in the rain, like we invented to sing. There's a light in the sky, from a million seasons.
It was a very arresting cover, I remember. And I was immediately just blown away. I thought it was an amazing album.
David Sinclair championed the album and made it the Times Album of the Year in 1986, which was an incredible, incredible accolade.
I think at some point I described just looking for some kind of snappy slogan. I said, oh, it's the best thing to happen to English rock since the first Clash album. And, I meant that.
Film the sunset, that's beautiful, look.
Very nice.
I'm pretty beautiful, but that's beautiful.
He was very ill. He was iller than we all realised that he realised.
Robert used to get these kind of weird, sort of like, what he used to describe as like nightmares during the day.
We play some songs and whatever, and you're just like, why can't I play this fucking song? I've been playing it for 10 years and suddenly just couldn't play it. The next week you forget a different song, but you played that one perfectly. It's just really, what's going on? And then, of course, we found out that he, you know, had a brain tumour.
So they cut a tumour the size of a golf ball or something out of his.
We're married and I still just can't get him to loosen up once in a while.
You couldn't discuss anything with him because his brain had changed so dramatically. And it was hard.
but harder for him because I don't think that he could really cope with it. And then he got pancreatic cancer, and then that was it.
I knew he'd been ill, but he didn't say how ill he was. He didn't tell anybody how ill he was.
It was Justin that phoned me.
I couldn't believe that we'd never see him again. And that the world had lost somebody who gave uns... And when you say this, this is like obituary stuff. Oh, he was a lovely man, you know, he gave unstintingly. But Robert really did.
There's sons and daughters now going to every gig when their mums and dads used to go, who met each other at a gig, got married, and now the whole family go.
I saw them play Beautiful Days last year, and as it came on, I was saying, wow, look at the audience. The audience at that gig must have been nearly all 18, 19, 20, super young crowd. Die Hard are still there, but they'd obviously be pushed back by this kind of younger audience. And for that to happen, to me, it told you a great story about the timelessness of New Modern Army's music. If you've got that emotional core in your music, and you actually write really good songs, they will transcend generations, and I thought this is actually living proof of that happening.
Impossible desire, impossible dream. We line them all up together and set off on the chase.
There's a black hole in music, and it's that marketing, sales, promotion, whatever black hole. That is the playground of a whole other group of people. New Model Army is a little bit too honest, a little bit too painfully real for that playground to profit. So I don't think they got put in front of as many people as they could have.
I think if they'd been huge, they'd have been huge for 3 years and broken up and wouldn't wanted to do it anymore. It would have broken them. I think this way is better, because they're still doing it the way they wanted to do it. I watched you as you tried and tried to pull the sun from out of the sky. The colours all run and the clouds collide, but that was never enough. Me, I've got a black place in my heart, my favourite chord, my favourite card that I draw.
He'll go on forever. He'll play until he physically can't play anymore.
I've been coming down here since I was a little boy. This is the place that I love the best, I think. It's about as beautiful as anywhere on earth, really. It's very familiar.